Hey guys, and welcome back to another Pro Guides Teamfight Tactics video. In today's video, we're going to be talking about positioning. Positioning as a whole can be a pretty hard topic to explain, since optimal positioning will often be different depending on your team comp and all of your opponent's team comps. But luckily, we broke it down to just a few basic, easy-to-apply scenarios and threw in a few tips for positioning against specific champions that you can use in your games as they come up. But first, I'd like to remind you to click on the link below and take a look at the updated ProGuides.com if you want to learn more about teamfight tactics. ProGuides will always have info on the newest patches, best builds, and strategies. There are all kinds of different resources from top players to help you guys be the best player that you can be, so be sure to check out ProGuides.com using the link in the description. Alright, so you want to learn how to properly position your units. You want to figure out why your champs sometimes just don't move and attack. You want to know how to counter that blitzcrank that always seems to tear apart your strategy. By the end of this video, you should hopefully have those answers and more. But in order to get there, it's important that we understand the basics. As I mentioned earlier, we've compiled a few basic positioning strategies and tips that you'll be able to apply to your games. These are probably common sense, but we'll start with these and then go more in depth with a few specific scenarios. 1. Make sure your tanks are tanking and your DPSs are DPSing. Obviously, TFT is a very different game from League of Legends. However, a lot of tactics for teamfights in League apply to teamfight tactics. You'll typically want your tanky units to be in the front line or the first row, while your ranged DPSs should be dealing most of the damage from the back line or the second or third rows while protected by your tanks. 2. Ults are very important. In the case of most champions, most of their damage or utility comes from their ult, so it would make sense that you should be keeping your champs alive long enough that they can fire off one ult at least. This goes for both tanks like Sejuani and damage dealers like Karthus. If a champion is dying fast enough that they don't even get a chance to ult, this is a sign that their position might not be the best it can be. 3. Know your opponent. While placing your champs in a generally good formation is a good way to play, knowing your opponents and paying attention to their positions can be even better. This allows you to avoid crucial ults while making sure yours can go off. Alright, so now that we have the most basic of information out of the way, let's go a little more in depth and learn how to do these things optimally. Positioning your tanks. So we mentioned earlier that you generally want your tanks on the front line or the first row, closest to your opponent's team. This way, they soak up most of the damage and keep non-assassins from getting to your backline DPS. In most cases, you also might want it to start as close as possible to the opponent's team so it can charge its ult faster or get a better position for its AoE. For example, you'd want a champ like Garen to end up right in the middle of your opponent's so he can maximize the damage with his ult. By positioning him closer to your opponents, it makes it so Garen draws the focus of all the opponent's champs and puts him in the perfect place to ult. Positioning your DPS. There are two different types of DPS, ranged and melee. We mentioned earlier that we would usually want ranged DPS in the back two rows, farthest away from the enemy team. This way, they can safely deal their damage while taking less in return. Especially in the case of rangers or most gunslingers who don't rely on their ults too much, it's even more important to have them furthest away so they take as little damage as possible. However, in the case of ranged DPSs like sorcerers who deal most of their damage by casting their ults, you usually would be better off positioning them in the second row. That way your tanks are still in the front line taking most of the damage, while the sorcerers are able to safely take a little bit of the splash damage from things like gunslingers or graves, which allows them to generate mana even faster. The other kind of DPS, melee, requires much different positioning. Typically, these will also go in the front line along with your tanks. It's a little hard to position them in the early game when everyone is still alive, since not everyone will position on the same side. But you want your tank to be closer to the opponent so it draws the focus, while your melee DPS can still deal damage while avoiding taking as much as possible. Making sure your ults go off. This is a very important part of teamfight tactics. Most of your damage and the key to turning fights around in TFT is going to come from your ults. One mistake a lot of new players make is assuming that since the battles happen automatically, they don't actually have to pay attention to them. Actually watching them and paying attention to whose ults are going off, yours or your opponent's, is very important in deciding your positioning. If your Sejuani is dying too fast and doesn't get a chance to ult, or if it's in a position where it gets focused by a Kassadin, you should probably consider moving it over so that another champion takes the focus and you can get your game-changing ult to go off. These are the types of things that you will start to notice by paying attention to each fight. It's also a good idea in general to watch the battles to learn how each champion will move and how champions choose a target to focus, as that will help you to make better decisions in your positioning. Knowing your opponents. Blitzcrank and the Hextech Synergy are really good disruption tools, but there's no reason they should completely shut you down. It's always a good idea to be scouting your opponent's boards in between rounds, looking for specific things that could hurt your comp. If you see they have a Blitz, make sure you don't have your carry in the opposite corner. Instead, you can play something like a Lulu, so when she gets pulled, she'll end up disrupting with her ult afterwards. On the other hand, if you're instinctively positioning around something like Blitzcrank or Hextech, and you find that no one is running either of those things, you can position more optimally and put your stacked Draven back in the corner. But team comps aren't the only thing you should be paying attention to when you're looking at opponents. It's also a good idea to keep track of the specific opponent you're playing against. With the current matchmaking for rounds in TFT, it's highly unlikely that you will play against the same opponent twice in a row. However, it's very likely that you'll play an opponent every other round. This can be useful in deciding how to position. For example, if you play against the one guy in your game running Blitzcrank one round, you know you won't play against him next, so you can feel safe moving a carry back into a corner. Or even more useful, in the late game, you can easily predict who you're going to play against when there are only three players left. If you play against someone one round, you know to position for the other player the next round because you'll either go against them or the Ghost Army. Assassins always jump to the farthest target they can get in range of. Since their nerf in patch 9.15, assassins jump before non-assassin champs start moving. This makes counterplay much easier. When playing assassins, you usually want to position them on the opposite side of the champ you would want the assassin to target. When playing against assassins, you want to group your champs into a corner. Since the assassins will jump before your champs move, the assassins will usually target the champion on the back line farthest from the corner, or the champion on the front line closest to the corner. You can use this to your advantage by positioning tanky champs there to take the assassin focus. Daisy will always spawn in a hexagon adjacent to a random elementalist if there's one available. By surrounding your elementalist with your other units or positioning them in a corner, you can make it so Daisy spawns in a specific spot. Typically, you would use this to ensure that Daisy spawns into your front line to tank for you, into a corner to bait a Blitzcrank pull, or into your back line to bait assassins. That brings us to the next special case, Guardians. Alone, each Guardian would usually be a tank that you would want on your front line. However, in order to get the most out of their synergy, it's usually best to place one in the second row, either directly diagonal of each other or using the positioning from the Elementalist example. By doing it this way, you have two hexagons where you can place champs and receive 100 armor from the Guardian buff, instead of placing them both in the front line and only one champion can receive 100 armor. Hextech is the newest origin in TFT. It randomly disables a champion's items and the items of champions 1 to 2 hexagons from them, depending on the amount of Hextech champions the player has. This makes it extremely easy to play around. You just want to make sure that you're keeping an eye out for players that have this synergy and that all of your champions with items aren't grouped up if you see players running it. Blitzcrank is one of the only solo champions that requires you to position around him. When playing him, you usually want him as far back as possible, and depending on the target you're pulling, you'll want a few champs far enough back that they'll focus the pulled target. Some popular examples are Kassadin, who will make sure the pulled target doesn't get a chance to ult, or Jinx, who will benefit from the early kill and be one step closer to getting excited. When playing against Blitzcrank, you want to make sure that your carries aren't going to be pulled. This is as simple as moving them one space over from the corner and putting another champ there instead. Usually good options would be something that would disrupt from that position, like Lulu or Gnar. Yasuo is another solo champion that requires specific positioning. His Exile buff gives him a shield equal to 100% of his max HP, but only if there are no other champions adjacent to him. Because of his extra HP, he makes a really nice tanky damage dealer who works well as a frontline. Like with Guardians, Daisy will spawn before Yasuo's Exile synergy goes off. This means you have to be extra careful with your Yasuo positioning if you're playing him with Elementalists. If you're not, Daisy can end up spawning next to Yasuo, denying his shield. There are many pros and cons to both sides, but it's important that you're able to recognize when you'd want either side. A lot of it depends on your comp and which side your opponents are playing on, since champ movement will be different. If your comp is heavily reliant on melee damage, or if you have a lot of AoE damage, you'd probably be better off placing everything on the opposite side that your opponents are placing on. Since everything is mirrored, your champs will line up with theirs, and when the battle starts, your champs won't have to travel far or at all. This means the opponent's teams will stay grouped up instead of spreading out, and champions like Aatrox can do major damage and Sejuani can get full stuns. However, if you have a lot of ranged DPS, you'll be better off placing everything on the opposite side that the opponents are placing on. When you go up against those opponents, both teams' tanks will have to walk to meet up in the middle. Meanwhile, your ranged DPSs will start firing off while their tanks are walking, meaning you're getting free damage. This is also the way you should position if your opponents have a lot of AoE, as you'll end up spreading out as your team walks to the middle. There's also a slight difference between the right and left corners. The right corner is only surrounded by two adjacent hexagons, while there are three hexagons surrounding the left corner. This can be useful when deciding which corner you want to place your carry in. By placing it in the right corner, it can't be jumped on by as many assassins or melees. Another mistake a lot of new players make is that they think the only formation you should be running are grouping your comp up in a corner. But like we talked about earlier, one good way to take advantage of this is by lining up your team with the team in a corner, so that way they stay grouped up for AoEs. So how do we play against that? Spread out your champs. A decent formation would be to leave an empty space between all of your champions, so that way not everything gets caught in a Sedge slash Cho stun, and you'll still have damage dealers even after some of your champs get CC'd. There are also specific items that require you to consider their positioning, especially Zephyr. Zephyr is a 5-second CC that will target the champion closest to the space on the opposite side of the champ equipped with it. When you are the player using it, you will get a tornado on the other side of the board that will help you figure out where the CC will go off, and you generally want to scout your opponent's boards and position your champ in a spot where you can remove the biggest threat to your team. That can be either a huge CC or a stacked hyper carry. When playing against it, you generally want to make sure that your champ that will get CC'd is one that will charge its ult quickly so that a 5-second CC won't set you back too far, or make sure the champ that's getting CC'd isn't necessary to beat the opponent's comp. Part of good positioning comes from understanding how pathing and champion's attack range works. This was a big problem for most players around the release of TFT, and still happens occasionally with new players. Outside of some weird cases, two champions cannot be in the same hexagon. Additionally, champions will try to move to a hexagon where there will be an enemy within their attack range. However, if there is no free hexagon near a target champion where your opponent would be within attack range, your champion will simply go AFK. For example, if the only enemy champion left alive is in their right corner and you have 5 melees, only 2 of your champions will be able to take up the 2 spaces surrounding that last corner, and your other 3 melees will stand around doing nothing. So how does all this apply to initial positioning? Let's take a look at this example of a player who tried to play around Blitzcrank. If your opponents are placing their champions on their left side so that you match up with them with this positioning, your Lucian and Tristana will be within attack range of a target right at the start of the fight. This means they won't move from their positions, and since Graves can't move through their hexagons, he'll be stuck in that corner until either Lucian or Tristana kill their target and have to move to their next one, or either of them die. Instead, it would be much better to move Lucian back to the left of Tristana, so that if you play against any player besides the Blitzcrank player, Graves can still move up and get into his DPS range. And with that, that's about all there is to positioning. Remember, there is no best formation that you can always use in every situation. It will always depend on your comp and your enemy's comps, but hopefully now you guys have a better understanding of the thought processes you should have going into positioning your comp, and you can make those decisions in your own games. But if you still have questions, be sure to ask in the comments below. Also, be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel and visit ProGuides.com to stay up to date on teamfight tactics. Good luck in all your games, and we'll see you on the next one.